Today's topic will be the characterization of high temperature materials using thermal analysis instruments. I want to introduce myself first of all. My name is Sebastian Seibt. I'm the head of laboratory here at Linzeis in Selb, Bavaria. I'm working here since 2013, and I'm mainly responsible for service measurements and application measurements, as well as the application lab. For those who do not yet know the company, Linzeis Messgeräte GmbH in German, it's a German company founded in 1956 by Dr. Maximilian Linzeis, who was an engineer, and he founded the company here in Selb, in the middle of Germany, in the northeast of Bavaria. In the meantime, his son, Mr. Klaus Linzeis, is our CEO, and his two sons, Mr. Florian Linzeis and Dr. Vincent Linzeis, are the lead of the management of the company. We have some facilities in the US as well as in China where we can do service measurements and repair and sales and service training as well. And our main business area is, of course, the manufacturing of instruments for thermal analysis, thermal electric materials, thermal conductivity, and everything that can be measured at higher and elevated temperatures. Besides that, as mentioned, we do service measurements in our own labs in the US, mainly China, and of course, Germany. The product range we are producing, as I just mentioned, is the complete range of thermal analyzers, beginning with calorimeters like differential scanning calorimeters, shortly DSC, thermogravimetric instruments, simultaneous thermal analysis instruments, which is the combination of DSC and TGA, dilatometers for thermal expansion measurements, and thermomechanical analysis, which is sort of a dilatometer that can apply stress and strain and higher forces. We offer a broad range of thermal conductivity and diffusivity, flash techniques, hot wire techniques, hot plate, guarded hot plate techniques. We have instruments for thermoelectric properties, thin film analysis, Hall effect measurements, and then we build a lot of special instruments for high pressure evolved gas analysis and so on. Just one second, there are some people that have some sound issues. I just checked something. Just one second. I try to improve that. If it's not getting better, you will receive the presentation afterwards, so you can listen to the presentation afterwards. Sorry for the interruption. As you can see on the current slide, there are some instruments marked red, and the techniques that are marked red here are the techniques that can be used at what I call high temperature, which I will describe in the next slide. So we are speaking today about mainly calorimetry and combined simultaneous thermal analysis, dilatometers, and thermal conductivity measurements at temperatures higher than 1600 centigrades. This brings me to the outline. First of all, I want to define what high temperature and thermal analysis means. And when we speak about high temperature, what high temperature for us means, which materials and applications are typically or are frequently asked in that range, and what thermal analysis does beyond 1600 centigrades. The instruments, as I said, I'm speaking about are mainly dilatometers, TGA, STA, and LFA. So mainly the phase behavior, melting, structural changes, specific heat and thermal conductivity and diffusivity range is of interest in that range. As said, we consider these instruments that are measuring in that range is higher than 1600 at special designed instruments. And we consider them as a specialized or customized version of a standard instrument. Therefore, they are manufactured on demand, and the customer and client has to tell us what exactly he wants to do. The typical applications for those kind of very high temperature measurements are engine science for planes, for jets, for spacecrafts, satellites, heat shields on the satellite or heat shield on the space shuttle when it comes back to Earth. Then fusion reactors or surface of fusion reactors, surface of nuclear power plants, reactor technique at all, furnace technique. So this is where all these high temperature materials come into play a role or come into account, which are mainly composites, graphites, borides, or some super alloys or some special metals that have a temperature range or sustainability higher than 1600-1700 centigrades. As said, I want to define what's high temperature. The term high temperature depends a little bit on the material and the application that someone is looking at. if humans speak about high temperatures, it can be meant that they are in an ambient temperature or in a desert or somewhere where the ambient temperature is higher than 40 centigrades. For polymers, high temperature already means that they are molten or decomposing, which is around 300 centigrades. However, graphite and some working materials like composites, graphites, high temperature ceramics, it's even higher than 2400, 2800 centigrades. In thermal analysis, there are two temperatures that mark the borderline to high temperature, which is on the one hand, the 1000 centigrades, and on the other hand, the 1600 centigrades. That comes from the fact that at around 1000 centigrade is the limit where the system needs an external furnace with an active cooling device to get rid of the heat during the measurement. So everything higher than 1000 centigrade is often called high temperature analysis. And besides that, at around 1600 centigrade is the limit where the most resistance heated furnaces like SiC furnace or Kanthal furnace or something like that are limited. So also the sample holders and usual DC sensors are limited at around 1600, 1650 centigrades. So when we are speaking about real high temperature and thermal analysis, we mean everything that's above 1600 centigrades, so a range that cannot be achieved by a classical resistance heated SiC furnace or something like that. So I'm focusing on applications and materials today that are used about way about 1600 centigrades. I already mentioned that these materials are mainly ceramics and refractories. They are used for structural constructions, for furnace interior, and for glass manufacturing and so on. And the melting point of the most ceramics is around 2000 centigrades and even higher. So the range about 2000 to 2400 centigrades is where the structural ceramics are used. Then of course there are metals that are used for thermocouples, for creating airplanes, creating space shuttles and so on. They have melting points. If you have steel alloys and special alloys out of tungsten or something like that, sinter metals, borons and so on, then you can easily reach the 2500 or even higher. So this is the other application where high temperature analysis really plays a big role. Polymers, as I mentioned, are limited to 300 centigrade and packaging and so on. Here the decomposition product can be of interest, but not really at that range. However, composite materials other than polymers, like graphite composites or glass fiber composites with graphite, with ceramics, can be used at ambient or from ambient temperature up to 2000 centigrades, which is also a frequent asked application. But what is not so interesting again is organic and pharmaceuticals. They are typically up to 200 centigrades, so they decompose or evaporate way before the high temperature is really reached. However, glasses and graphite, as mentioned, are what really comes into account when you talk about high temperatures. As I showed you in the introduction, I want to mainly focus on three techniques: dilatometers, thermogravimetric and calorimetric analysis, and thermal conductivity measurements at temperatures higher than 1600 centigrades. The first thing would be taking a closer look on the dilatometers. First of all, dilatometers, what is it? For those who do not know how exactly it works and what we can do, we have horizontal and vertical versions. They look like, as you can see on these pictures, we can run one, two, or even four samples at the same time with an automatic pressure control. Speaking about high temperature analysis, every dilatometer that goes higher than 1600 centigrades is in a vertical setup. So everything that has a furnace that goes higher than 1600 centigrades has to be set up vertical. Of course, there are horizontal versions. However, if you go higher than 1600, you need a graphite tungsten furnace, you are in a vertical design. Why? This is for the heat management. If you have very high temperatures and heat spread between the cold detection electronics and the hot furnace and sample zone, you get convection, and therefore to avoid these convection effects, the vertical setup has some benefits. That's why high temperature or analyze about 1600 centigrades is in a vertical setup usually. This slide shows the dilatometer view range in general. As said, we have horizontal dilatometers, optical methods. We have dilatometers can handle up to four samples at the same time. Deformation with inductive coils, pressure dilatometers, and even laser dilatometers. However, the versions that go higher than 16 centigrades are all in the vertical platform L75, just that you have heard that. A dilatometer, what it does, as I mentioned, it measures the thermal expansion. This is performed by contacting a sample by a push rod, and the push rod is leading into a measurement system. Usually there are two options. On the one hand, there is a LVDT magnetic measurement system. So there's an electric magnet that more or less records the movement of the push rod system. And when the push rod moves, the core of the magnet moves, and out of that, you get an electrical signal that directly describes the angle or the way the sample expands or shrinks. On the other hand, you can use optical encoder techniques. So you have bending strips connected to the push rod. So if the push rod moves, these bending strips are moving. And then there are optical encoder detectors that monitor the movement of the bending strip. And out of that, you get also information about the shrinkage or expansion of the sample. The sample itself is placed in the measurement sample holder. And the sample holder here is this white area around the push rod and the sample. And the whole thing is put into a tube. And this tube is within a furnace. And the green thing here is insulation material. And this coil around it is the heater. So this is the general setup of a dilatometer for those who do not know and who are not aware how it works. The push rod itself can be just a flat push rod for classical expansion measurements. I mentioned that for a kind of special version is a TMA, thermal mechanical analyzer. So you cannot only have a push rod for classical expansion measurement. There are also push rods that just sample in one point or in a defined small area for penetration experiments, for E-modulus determination, for volumetric expansion, tension experiments, and so on. However, the way it acts is always the same. The push rod is connected to a detector and monitors the expansion and shrinkage of the sample. No matter if you just apply a constant force, if you have fluctual force, so sinusoidal force, so push and pull, and so on. Just that you have seen more or less in a summary what a dilatometer can do. As said, the general setup differs between horizontal and vertical setup. I just want to mention that the vertical setup has lesser friction as the sample stands on the push rod and is connected only by the end plate here. In the horizontal version, it has contact to the whole rod, so you can have a little bit friction. However, the sample handling in a horizontal version is a little bit easier than in a vertical version. Just that you have seen that and you know what we are speaking about. Now, coming to the high temperature range of the dilatometers. As mentioned, the furnace of the dilatometer is more or less an option. So you can apply any kind of furnace on the dilatometer. The pushrod system and the detection system will always be the same setup. However, the furnace and the heating element within the furnace decides or defines what temperature range the dilatometer can reach and what temperature range the sample can be measured. As you can see here, we have liquid nitrogen versions up to around 500, 700, 1000 centigrades, and they are made of thermocoax heating elements, allow any kind of atmosphere, have a type K thermocouple directly at the sample to detect the sample temperature. So this is what we call the classical dilatometer range. No matter if there's a cooler or not, around 1000 centigrades is what a classical dilatometer can measure. If you want to go beyond that, if you want to go higher than 1000 centigrade, it depends a little bit on the heating and cooling speed you want to achieve, what kind of heater you can use. For the instance, we offer around 1400 centigrades, we offer Kanthal heaters. Higher than that, we offer SIC heaters for around 1600 centigrades. And as silicon carbide heaters are very frequently used, this is more or less the limit where or why thermal analysis considers 1600 or 1650 centigrades as the limit, as the border to the real high temperature applications. As you can see here, there's a platinum option. You can have a platinum rhodium furnace that goes a little bit higher than the SIC heater, around 1650, and then that's the limit. If you go higher than that, you need a heating element that can heat higher, that has more power output, more irradiation output, which is usually graphite or even tungsten. Graphite heaters have the advantage they can reach much higher temperatures because they do not melt or do not decompose up to around 3000 centigrades. However, they have the little disadvantage that they react with oxygen very heavily. So you need a second wall around your heater. So your furnace has then a double wall. You just remember the slide where I showed you the furnace. if you have a graphite heater and not a resistance heater anymore, not a SiC or platinum heater, you need a double wall. So there's another chamber that is either with vacuum or with inert gas flushed around the heater to protect the heater from oxidation. So therefore, graphite heaters are a little bit special. And in the inside, they allow only nitrogen or vacuum. I would rather use vacuum or helium and not nitrogen atmosphere to avoid reaction between nitrogen and graphite at real high temperature. The next problem is that the thermocouple that's connecting your sample and detects the sample temperature and that range cannot be done anymore out of the usual metals. So type S would be a platinum wire, type K would be a nickel constanton wire. This is not possible at that range anymore. The problem is that your thermocouple will melt or will react, and therefore you have to use a pyrometer. Pyrometers are IR detectors that look at a certain surface with a defined emissivity, and out of the grade of emissivity, it can measure the temperature. That limits you a little bit at the lower range, at the lower end, around room temperature, up to, I would say, 500 centigrades. The pyrometers have an uncertainty that's much bigger than the thermocouple. However, they allow you and enable you to reach up to 2,800 centigrades, depending on the heating element. There are some questions. I will answer these questions after the talk. Just a short thing, because somebody mentioned that. The graphite heaters are resistance heaters. Sorry to confuse you. Graphite heaters are also resistance heaters. They are empowered by DC voltage. And when DC voltage is empowered to the graphite, they glow like a resistance heater does it at the same way. The only difference is that the graphite has to be used in a protective atmosphere. We have inductive heaters as well, but not the graphite heater. So as said, the L75 dielectrometer series can be equipped with that kind of furnace. I just want to show you how that looks like. So if you just keep in mind that how a normal classical dielectrometer looks like, this is if you have a 2,800 centigrade graphite furnace, you need a little bit bigger power supply cables. You'll need a second hull around your heaters. You need a cooler. Therefore, this bigger cooling unit is applied. You need a gas control for the inner and for the outer gas cycle. And so this is how the setup looks like if you really want to go up to 2,800 centigrades. The advantages, you can cover the whole range. You have high precision pyrometers, so you can detect very precisely at the upper edge. However, you lose a little bit precision at the lower end of the range. Heating rates are possible up to 100 centigrades per minute over the full range. Just to mention that this is a little bit more than I would use for a dielectrometer experiment, because you have to make sure that your sample is heated homogeneously. If you use such a high heating rate in a dielectrometer, your sample surface will be much hotter than the interior of your sample, and therefore the expansion value will be wrong. But the theoretical physical border, or what's possible, would be around 100 centigrade per minute. It's designed for the usage of pure atmospheres. I would use helium. I would recommend to use helium. They are designed to that you can use vacuum, nitrogen, and helium to avoid the formation of nitriles or CN molecules. I would use rather helium or vacuum than nitrogen. The sample size and sample shape is the same like in the classical dielectrometer. So you can use up to 20 millimeter diameter, and you can use up to 50 millimeter length. I would recommend to use a little bit smaller samples. So my recommendation would be 20 millimeter in length, around 4 to 5 millimeter diameter to get good results, as this is the size of the standard and reference materials we are using. Before you ask, the reference material for dielectrometer at that range will always be graphite. No sapphire, no alumina, because they will melt. Therefore, for that kind of dielectrometer, you need to use a graphite reference. Then I have some measurements for you to show that the range is really possible. This shows you the graphite run of a reference graphite standard from room temperature up to 2,800 centigrades. That you can see we cover the whole range. I'm sorry for the bad graphics that I just extracted that out of a measurement right before the presentation. I didn't have a better picture of that. So what you can see here is a graphite reference material that was measured from room temperature up to 2,800 centigrades in the linear heating rate. It was around 10 Kelvin or 10 centigrades per minute. And as you can see, you see a more or less linear signal for the whole range. The green curve shows you the absolute expansion. The red curve is the relative expansion divided by L0, so in percentage. And the blue curve shows you the CTE of that sample. As you can see, the lower edge around 500 centigrades, the values are not so good quality. That's because the pyrometer that is used here has a lower accuracy in that range. However, it gets very linear and very constant at higher and elevated temperatures. That's where the pyrometer works a little bit better. So this is the disadvantage of the high of the 2800 centigrade version. The pyrometer is a little bit inaccurate in the first 500 centigrades, just that you have seen how a measurement looks like. I have another measurement for you that's, that was done a little bit better, and I did have time to work on the graphics. This is the linear expansion of a tungsten rod. As I mentioned, tungsten is one of the metals and one of the materials that has a melting point higher than 3000 centigrades. So it's a very hard material and very high melting material that's sometimes used in, as I said, spacecraft and engine design, where real high temperature plays a role or comes into account. Or sometimes it's also used for reactor buildings and to form super alloys that can withstand high temperatures. And as you can see here, this is the relative expansion from around room temperature or even lower up to 2800 centigrades. This curve was measured by two devices. The higher end of the range was measured by the 2800 centigrade dilatometer, and the lower end of the range was measured by a low temperature dilatometer. And the combined data gives that complete coverage curve that covers from minus or from liquid nitrogen temperature minus 180 up to 2800. So just to show you, we can cover with our instruments the full range what's possible. And this is the range of thermal analysis that you can achieve and that you can cover. Just be aware of that. One thing I wanted to show you, which is a little bit out or off topic, on the other edge, we also have a dilatometer that can work with a helium cryostat. So we cannot only do very high temperatures, we also can do very low temperatures. So this is going down up to around, I would say, 4 or 5 Kelvin. Of course, the cooling rate is a little bit lower then, but the liquid helium enables you to go down to 4 or to 5 Kelvin, so minus 269 centigrades. And this is how we could even and longer or enlarge the range. So could get even a little bit lower here in coverage, just that you have heard and seen that. Yeah, this is the curve of sample that was cooled down to around 5 Kelvin and then heated up, and the expansion was measured at the same time, just that you're aware that real complete range is possible. Besides the dilatometers, as mentioned before, the same for the STA. So STA means simultaneous thermal analysis. For those who do not know, it's a combination of DSC and TGA, so calorimetry and thermogravimetry. And also here, the complete range is possible. Again, just for those who are not aware how it works, this is a schematic drawing of an STA instrument. So it's a thermobalance. What you can see on the stream is there's a basic unit with a balance, and this is a balance bar that's a compensational balance. So you have counterweight, you have an electric magnet. On the side where the magnet is placed, there is a sample holder, the yellow part here, that's connected to the balance unit. And this sample holder goes up into the furnace. Again, like in the dilatometer, we have a furnace. Within the furnace, we have a kind of sample holder with a sensor surrounded by heating elements with some insulation materials surrounded by a furnace. There's an inner tube. The tube has an open coupling, so that allows you to analyze the gas that comes out. If you make a decomposition reaction, you can analyze the gas. But the setup is similar to the dilatometer. So you have a furnace with an inner tube, depending on the temperature range. And there's a sample and the reference. The DSC basically has a sensor that has two crucibles in there. There's a reference crucible and the sample crucible. And what you measure is the difference in temperature between these two crucibles. So if these two crucibles have the same temperature, the difference will be zero. You will have no signal. At the moment, your sample is consuming energy or releasing energy. It gets hotter or colder than the empty crucible. So the difference between the two will be different from zero. And out of that, you can see if it's endothermic or exothermic and how much energy is flowing. In the same time, the whole thing is placed on the balance. So if you lose mass or increase your sample mass, you will see the signal of the balance by the electric magnet over here. You see if the balance is lifting or lowering, and therefore you see if the mass changes. The whole thing is in a closed environment. So you have gas connectors for purge gas and sample gas. So this is how a classical thermobalance is set up. Again, we have a range that covers low temperature, high temperature, different applications. We have a STAPD1000 with an integrated microheater furnace. It's considered a small instrument. Then we have the SAPT1600 platform with the 1600 centigrade external furnace. And again, here we are modular, so you can remove and replace this furnace by any other kind of furnace. So this is the setup that can be equipped with tungsten and graphite furnaces for high temperature. Besides that, we have pressure balancers, magnetic suspensions, or contact-free versions, which I will not mention in detail here, but we have high pressure versions that can go up to 100, 200, 300 bar, depending on the model, and the tabletop pressure version. The basic platform, the SAPT1600, as well as the high pressure balance, can be equipped with high temperature furnaces that go higher than 1600 centigrade. So speaking about high temperature analysis, these two model series are what I'm speaking about, just that you are all aware of that. Again, we come to the furnace program, and as you remember, or you might remember from the dilatometer, the furnaces are pretty much the same. So we have Kanthal and low temperature furnaces. In contrast to the dilatometer, we have an IR heater furnace available that has an infrared irradiation heater that allows a little bit higher heating and cooling rates. But besides that, the furnace program is more or less the same like on the dilatometer. I just explained that. And again, we have a platinum rhodium furnace that goes up to 1650. And then we can offer a molybdenum silicide furnace that goes up to 1750 that can be still operated with a thermocouple type B. Thermocouple type B is consisting also of platinum rhodium thermocouple, is a little bit inaccurate at room temperature, but still accurate up to 1750. And then, like on the dilatometer furnace program, if you go higher than that, if you go beyond that, you're at graphite or graphite tungsten furnaces. So you can go up to 2400 centigrade on the balance with a tungsten furnace, with a graphite furnace. Again, you have to use reducive or inert atmospheres, means helium or vacuum or nitrogen. And usually we have pyrometers here. We can use C-type. You might ask why there's no pyrometer mentioned here, why there's C-type. The problem is, if you really want to use the DSC option and want to get a calorimetric signal, as I mentioned before, you have to somehow measure the difference between sample crucible and reference crucible. And this would not be possible by pyrometers. So therefore, first of all, the balance is limited, or the STA is limited around 2400 centigrades, and it's not operated by pyrometers in that case. If you want to do DSC, it has a thermocouple that's made out of tungsten, so a type C. If you use it as a balance only, as a pure TGA, thermographic gravimetric instrument, you can use a pyrometer, and then you can even increase the temperature range. But if you want to use the DSC option, there's a type C thermocouple that's very sensitive, and not every sample is possible to measure. It depends a little bit on the sample type. Yeah, as I mentioned, there are some special furnaces like the molybdenum silicide and the IR and high frequency furnace for some very special applications. But this is the more or less furnace program that you have to be aware of. Again, what is it used for? The STA, as I said, just heat release, heat uptake, and at the same time you can measure the composition by measuring temperature, weight change over temperature. Sorry. One very frequently asked example is, for instance, measuring the melting point of ceramic parts that are even used in furnace construction and even in construction of our instruments. So I have shown you here an example where the melting point of alumina, which is used for making the sensors, for making the interior of our SiC furnaces. So how the alumina behaves at higher temperatures and when it is melting and when it is crystallizing. What you can see, the green curve shows you the temperature. So we have a linear heating up to around, I would say, 1800. At 1800, the heating rate was a little bit lowered and to the maximum of 2400. And then we cooled that. And then even at 1800, we increased the cooling speed. At the range of around 2000 or 2072 centigrades, what you can see is on the DSC curve, you see a small peak. And during cooling, you see another peak in the other direction. The crystallization peak is always a little bit more sharper than the melting peak. It's a little bit higher, but a little bit more narrow. And the melting peak is here on the heating curve, of course. The TG signal just shows you a little jump or a little effect at the switch from heating to cooling, which is normal, but no other effects, so no bigger mass loss and so on. So this is not a mass loss. This is just an effect when the heating was switched to the cooling. So it's an effect of the gas flow inside of the furnace, because if the heat is turned off and the cooler goes on, the balance signal is a little bit affected here. So this is not a mass loss, just to explain. And as I said, the orange curve shows you the melting peak and the crystallization peak of the alumina that's used in our furnaces. There's a little mistake here, sorry. So the sample was measured in helium in that case, and this was a graphite furnace. I have to mention one thing. Thing is, if you want to use a graphite furnace, you have to be aware that sometimes there are small graphite particles released from the inner tube, and that can affect the measurements. If you use a glass fiber or glass fiber graphite inner tube like we do, you can minimize that, so you are able to measure sensitive samples, but you cannot exclude that there are some small graphite parts affecting your tungsten systems or your tungsten of your thermocouple samples. And that's sometimes a little bit of a problem, just that you are aware of that. And finally, the last instrument I want to introduce to you is the high temperature laser flash instrument. As I mentioned, we can measure thermal conductivity by different methods, which are wire methods, which are heat flow meters, guarded hot plates, and so on, but mainly also flash technique. The thermal conductivity range that is covered by all these methods is shown here. So we have, as I said, heat flow meter, that's for insulation materials, guarded hot plate. They are all around, I would say, 600, 700 centigrades. Hot wire techniques can be even used in furnaces that go up to 1,500 centigrades, but not by our company. And they are guarded heat flow meters that go around 300 centigrades. And then we have interface material testers and so on. And they, as you see, they are all limited somewhere in temperature range. And the only method that covers a very big range is the flash technique. The advantage of flashing is it's fast, and measuring thermal diffusivity and conductivity always is not so easy. The longer it takes, the more difficult it gets to get homogeneous temperature spread, to get a defined amount of heat flowing through your sample. And that's the reason why the flash technique is the only thing that covers really the whole range up to 2,400 centigrades. The flash technique covers not only the range of temperature, it covers also the range of conductivity. If you have a look on the axis here, thermal conductivity is, a lot of investigations are taking place around 0 to 1 or 0 to 10, which is the thermal conductivity of most materials like insulations, rubbers, polymers, and so on. However, if you consider metals, diamonds, graphite, and other materials, especially the high temperature materials like graphite, they have much higher conductivities, and therefore you have to cover the range up to 1000 watt per meter Kelvin to analyze them. And you also have to cover the complete temperature range. And this is why the flash technique is the only one that's suitable here. Again, for those who do not know how the flash technique works or how laser flash technique in general works, it's not so difficult to understand. Again, you can see on the first look that there is again a kind of furnace, of course. Within the furnace, like always, there's a sample holder where the samples are placed, which is right in the middle here. And then what the laser flash, or can it also be a xenon flash, or what the flash technique basically does is, you have a light source that can be a xenon lamp, that can be a laser, and somehow a focused beam is created depending on the source of light or the source of energy. And this beam hits your sample on a definite area or on a definite surface. The idea is to exactly know how much heat energy, so how much irradiation is hitting your sample. That can be controlled by the pulse shape, pulse length, and the energy the pulse is created, the laser pulse is created. Same for the flash lamp. If you know your settings, if you know the energy you put in, you know exactly how much heat energy and what time hits your sample surface. In the case of the flash techniques, from the one side, a small shot or energy is hitting the sample. And on the top side of the sample, so on the opposite side, there's a detector that looks with an iris and an amplifier on the surface on the opposite side. So what you get shortly after the heat is transferred into the sample, the detector sees how much heat is flowing to the opposite side and on what time is needed for that. And out of that, you get the time and the temperature on the opposite side. And this is what you need to calculate thermal diffusivity by a model. So this is the schematic experimental setup. On the right side, you see how the sample holder looks like. So the samples are contacted or fixed only at the border or only at the edge. From the bottom side, The flashlight hits the sample. On the top side, the detector sees the sample. On the scheme here, you see that there is a power source. There is a pulse or beam shaped that hits the sample area. On the top side, the radiation that's emitted by the sample goes into a detector. The detector creates a signal. The signal can be seen here. So shortly after the pulse, which takes place at time zero, the temperature at the surface, at the top surface of the sample, increases to a certain plateau. The height of the increase and the time that the increase takes gives you directly the thermal diffusivity. So more or less the speed, how fast the heat is transferred through the sample. If you know the density and the specific heat capacity of your sample, you can calculate thermal conductivity out of the measured diffusivity times the density times the specific heat capacity. So temperature rise on the sample surface is fit by a model. I do not want to go too deep into theory. The only thing you have to know is there are some effects that have an influence. They are all calculated by the model and more or less taken into account. And out of this mathematical fit model, there are many publications, there are different models. We use a combined model that takes heat loss and irradiation, by the way, but as I said, I do not want to go into detail here. Out of these models, you get a mathematical fit, you get a shape of the pulse, and out of the shape, you can calculate the thermal diffusivity, just that you have seen that. And that brings me to the applications. We have various samples that can be measured. The LFA or the flash technique is a non-linear method. So you have no heating rate, and every second or every minute you get a data point. No, you have to heat to a certain temperature, like in that application here, every 100 centigrade, there was a measurement taken. So you heat your complete sample up to 100 centigrades, for instance. And then at 100 centigrades, a few pulses are fired on the sample and a few measurement points are recorded. The average value is taken and you get a value for thermal diffusivity. In that case, two different alloy samples were just investigated. And so you have two positions in the sample holder, and then to both positions, there was at each 100 centigrades, one data point recorded, resulting in curves like this. If you know the CP and density of your sample, you can get out of the thermal diffusivity, mainly by the flash technique, also specific heat, and out of the specific heat and thermal diffusivity, calculate thermal conductivity. So the thermal conductivity is the black curve, thermal diffusivity would be the blue one, and this light blue one is specific heat. The LFA, by the way, can determine specific heat by doing a comparative experiment. So if you have a reference sample with no specific heat and your unknown sample that behaves similar to the reference, you can determine specific heat by comparing it to a reference. And out of the specific heat and the measured thermal diffusivity that you primarily measure, you can calculate thermal conductivity. Again, this is data point by data point. Now, if you want to do that at higher temperatures than around 1400, 1600 centigrades, which is the normal furnace program is used, by the way, I just forgot the one slide. Of course, for the LFA, we have the same furnace program like for the dilatometer and the STA again. And again here, going higher than 1600 centigrade brings us directly to the graphite and tungsten furnace. So the furnaces are again the same that I just showed you twice now. For the LFA, there's a graphite furnace and there's a tungsten furnace. One thing for the LFA I want to mention here, and I have to mention that, is usually you make sure that the amount of heat that the sample takes up is always the same by coating your sample with a graphite layer. So you coat your sample with a graphite, the graphite heat uptake is known. So by graphite coating of your sample, you exactly know how much energy is taken up by the sample and how much emissivity means what temperature at the top side. The problem is at the range above 2000 centigrades, especially when measuring metals, these metals form alloys with graphite. So the graphite coating is not possible anymore. In that case, we use special ceramic coatings like zirconium or zirconia coatings or alumina coatings, depending on the temperature range. And the other point is graphite furnaces are sometimes causing problems, especially when measuring metals. In that case, this measurement shows you a tungsten sample of 12.7 millimeter diameter and 2.5 or 2.7 millimeter thickness that was measured every 100 centigrades up to 2400. This was performed not by a graphite furnace, this was a tungsten measure sample in a tungsten sample holder, also in a tungsten furnace. The reason is tungsten and graphite react with each other, and in the LFA, if you use a graphite furnace, sometimes you can have influence, and this is why sometimes if you see such measurements, also with our instruments, at elevated temperatures, these values get a certain error or have a higher uncertainty because of the reaction between the graphite layer or coating, or if you do not use graphite coating, like in that case, between some graphite that's released from the heaters that affect or can affect the metal. So therefore, we use a tungsten furnace for that high temperature range. So this is about the high temperature techniques I wanted to introduce to you. So far, thank you for your attention. I just wanted to make sure that you are aware that we can really cover the complete range and that you are aware what high temperature means in thermal analysis.